TED has evolved. So when I was asked to do this, I thought each time I talk about something I'm doing or someone else is doing or why I think you should be doing something. And I thought, how could I sort of be meta, sort of pop up a level and maybe share with you some of the things about talking in general. And this is not a word. It's not a real word. It doesn't exist in the dictionary. But, you know, if you do retrospection and you do introspection, and there might be a word for futurespection, I just chose that word to try and do the following. Let me give you three examples of speeches I've given in the past 10 days. I gave a speech on food, and I don't know so much about food, but issues like sort of genetically modified food is the right direction to go, and that agro doesn't need arable land in the future, and we will eat meat without cows. So you learn quickly some of the things that are really going to happen. And then I had to give one shortly before that on energy, where I was, and I'm really not an energy expert, but I do know that solar panels and solar energy is just an interim step. The future of sustainable energy is nuclear. It's nuclear fusion, not fission. It's nuclear fusion, QED. It really will be. Now, whether it's 10 years, whether it's, it doesn't matter. In the long term, that is the solution. And so when you look at these things, and cities, I think, was my most recent one, and in the case of cities, you can tell that suburbs will not exist in the future. The concept of suburbs is going away. So why do people ask me to talk? Typically, they ask me to talk because I'm going to say something outrageous, I'm going to say something sort of controversial, and I promise you I will not disappoint this afternoon. But I wanted to talk about it in terms of having, if you will, been to the future, in the sense that I'll say something will happen in 10 years, and then you are there, and the 10 years it did or didn't happen. So you've gone through these loops. I only show you this very, very quickly, because when I was a student in the 60s, this particular project was done in 65, this was a computer-aided routing system for automobiles to get cars to pick you up at one location and drop you off in another. 1965. And today we think Uber's invented something. No, this is old stuff. But the reason it works is things in history line up. They line up. We get GPS, which didn't exist at the time. We have phones in our pocket. We've got Google Maps. We have texting. We have all these other things that then, boom, make it work. And I just, that's sort of a close-up. It was actually a display, one of the first displays. I show this because it was a project we did, and we almost got what was called the Proxmire Award. This was an award that a senator gave for the most irrelevant, gratuitous government-paid research. And we were nominated. I wish we had won it. It would have been a badge of honor. And we had this truck driving up and down the streets of Aspen. Aspen is what prompted Proxmire. At 1978, so 35 years later, Google's driving trucks around. So it's the timing. And so, and I won't dwell on touch, but what I'm going to do is pick three topics. And I'm going to devote a couple of minutes to each. And what are sort of some of the counterintuitive, somewhat outrageous, but I think perfectly true propositions that relate to learning. So the first thing I think we should do is stop testing. If you look at some of the high scores in the so-called PISA test. These are the comparisons of 12th graders around the world. The United States is always below the 50th percentile, and Finland is always either at the top or very close to it. And when it's at the top, it's often an outlier. Sweden has no testing kindergarten through 12th grade, no homework kindergarten through 12th grade, shortest days per year, shortest hours per day. And you say, wait a minute. We think we're going to make our education system by goosing up the hours, by having more testing, giving the kids more homework, and they're doing the exact opposite. Why does it work? And it doesn't just work because it's a 6 million population of more homogeneous people than we are. It is the, as a country, is bigger than any school district in the United States. And the non-Swedes, the immigrants, represent only 8 or 9%, but it is still something we should look at. And if you take one thing like age segregation, Montessori knew this years ago. Why do we have all the kids that are five-year-olds studying with five-year-olds and then move on to be six, and the six-year-olds study with six-year-olds? The reason is because it's convenient for testing. It's not the right thing to do. Anybody who has siblings knows it. Any parent knows it, that age segregation and stopping testing are very, very important. Very counterintuitive. The whole reason that the Finns do so well is that those kids learn without competition. It's a collaborative process. And so to make it a competitive one, of which parents are complicit in this, is really quite tragic. So number two. Number two is about new ideas. Where do new ideas come from? And let's think about ideas. The Media Lab has 500 people in it. It's been about that size for a decade, maybe a little bit more. And they do very various things. I want to talk about big ideas. Where do big ideas come from? And those of you who knew Marvin Minsky, he's alive and well, but this is Marvin about 25 years ago. Marvin is the kind of person who thinks has big ideas. Well, big ideas come from differences. Big ideas come when there are different cultures, different backgrounds, different age groups, and they're all sort of intermixed. And a place like the Media Lab is a perfect place to do that, because out of the 500 people, 25% replenish themselves each year. And the incoming 25% are always between 22 and 26 or 7, whatever the number is. It's like a fountain of youth, and they come from everywhere. We do our own admissions. You do not even have to have a high school degree to get into the Media Lab's graduate program. We reach far and wide and have done it for years and years. And what do? We do things that normal market forces won't. And it's very important, I tell this to the people at the Media Lab, if market forces will do what you're doing today, stop. Don't do it. Our obligation is to do the things that aren't going to happen by normal market forces. And there's a new F word, and it really drives me crazy, partly because you get so many young minds now being sucked out of the big thinking world to do some little startup. Now, I'm not against startups. I've funded 60 of them. I've been part of the venture capital community, but we've gone too far. It's like a brain drain. And we're kids, it's so much more fun to do a little app with your boyfriend or girlfriend or your classmates, and you spin it and you flip it and you go on. And this is called entrepreneurship. Well, the new F word is focus, because I wish people wouldn't focus. I get people who leave the Media Lab to start a company, which is already putting blinders on, in a small particular area, and their VCs come to them and their investors and say, focus. You've got to focus. That's too focus, focus. And so the focus word, which to me is an F word, is in fact making people even think smaller. I was with a startup recently, which I'm very enthusiastic about. He's doing synthetic meat, and he's making tons and tons of porterhouse steaks from the DNA of a cow. Arguably, vegetarians might eat this. It uses almost no water. It's done in a petri dish. It would change the world. Meat, meat galore, marbleized thick pieces of meat that come from a petri dish, not a cow. Wouldn't that be fantastic? Well, his VCs came along and said, well, you better do leather to practice, because that'll give you cash flow positive and you'll get, you know, and so let's put leather first. Huh? You know, so every story I hear, there's a leather equivalent, which takes a really big idea, makes it small. So the last thing I want to talk, the third and last, is about civics. And here, I think this is very, very important, because many of us too quickly are willing to say that there is a philanthropic, charitable, NGO, nonprofit world on one side, and then on the other side, there is the entrepreneurial, business, sort of corporate, commercial world, and those are the two worlds. Well, no. Those may be the two worlds, but there is a third one which we have, for the past 30 years, pissed on. We don't encourage our kids to get involved with the public realm. We say to ourselves, oh, we'll just let the market do it. Now, the market really screws up in cities. And if you don't think so, go visit the seaport. The seaport is a perfect example of a screw-up because we felt market forces will do better. So planning, people had off, we didn't do any planning, didn't do simple things where you could have created a fabulous environment, not by having the government make government housing so it looks like a little diminutive sort of block of Russian housing, but by using some very simple forms of looking at sort of how the public realm works in architecture. And sort of a slightly higher level corollary is capitalism is not democracy. And if I say that in Washington, I'm considered unpatriotic, not just to the Republicans either. It's considered synonymous. Of course, capitalism is not true. In fact, amongst the happiest, richest, finally, you look at those list countries in the world, they're social democracies. It's socialism in a democratic form, which is very, very important. So I end on what is mine. My time is up, so what am I doing? I'm trying to make connectivity a human right, not a commercial enterprise, a human right. And we can connect every person in this world within 4 years to the internet free. So I don't mean low cost, I mean free. Free like sidewalks, free like lighting in the street, part of the public realm. And that's my mission for the next whatever number of years. Thank you.